Mic check. Okay, thank you. It is an honor for me to greet you all for this first roundtable of Subversive Conference. And in the spirit of its title, which is New International, we will continue in English language because I suppose not many of us here know Esperanto. I would like to make a short introduction, a really, really short one, which would be based on the introductory text that was published on a Subversive Festival site, which starts with year 1990 and the ecstatically proclaimed end of the history. Because of course, fall of the Berlin Wall and collapse of Eastern communist or real socialist existing bloc. But this phase hasn't long lasted for long, and with the occurrence of real global crisis of capitalism or capitalist crisis, the world has seen insurgence of many anti-systemic movements all around the globe, which were mostly horizontal organized and were anti-systemic in a way that they refused the old representational democracy and liberal democracy and the capitalist democracy, as I would say. After that, the next phase that we are witnessing now is a step further, when many participants of those movements all around the world realize that there are limitations of such organizational principle, and tried to form political powers that would try to challenge neoliberal consensus in a parliamentary field of struggle. So here we have representatives of four such organizations, four such parties that are in a really different stages of their development. We have a representative from Syriza, Yiannis Bournous. He is a member of Syriza's political committee, and he is responsible for international networking, and he is also a member of executive committee of Party of European Left. Introduced was Pablo Bustindui from Podemos, but he has some health problems. We wish him soon and quick recovery, but we are glad to greet Antonio Sánchez, which is responsible of political organization in Brussels and representative in the EU Parliament, and he's a part of political secretary committee of Podemos. Then we have Marko Milošević here, that is a member of and a member of Workers' Party, Workers' Front, Croatian, in the freshest of them all initiatives, and he is also a member of coordination committee of Workers' Front. And at the end, I shuffled you all with no order at all. Luka Mesec, which is a member of Initiative for Democratic Socialism from Slovenia. He's a representative in Slovenian parliament and coordinator of Council of Initiative for Democratic Socialism, also a part, which is also a part of coalition United Left in Slovenia. So the exciting times are in front of European left, and political landscape is changing all over the Europe. Somewhere not so much in favor of what we would like, but the left parties are rising, or left-leaning parties are rising in some other parts of Europe. So I think that it would be the best for us in this happening to focus on present time and prospects for the future, but of course we cannot skip the some introductionary context of what has happened and how the crisis broke out. We are all experiencing the same global crisis, but it has manifested itself accordingly to different economic structures and political structures of each country in a different ways. So first I would like to give a chance for our participants here to try to describe us briefly what really happened in their countries in those years, and how did the society reacted to those sometimes disastrous consequences of this crisis. So I don't know, maybe in order, left to right, or right to left. Okay, so then Luka first.
Okay, first of all, thank you for inviting me to this beautiful conference, and of course thank to you to attend the panel. Now, if I try to present shortly what happened in Slovenia in the last 20 years, I would say that we had, in short, three phases. First, we had, let's say, a phase of gradual transition in the 90s. Then we had a neoliberal phase after 2004, and we have the period of crisis, especially after 2008 in Slovenia. So if I try to give you some picture of what has happened, I would say that Slovenia it was the Slovenian transition was a bit different than in other transitional countries. In the 90s we had basically left-center oriented governments from the 1993 to 2004, and they tried to manufacture some kind of social democratic political and economical system in Slovenia. They started with, for instance, tripartite negotiations between capital, labor, and the state. They retained a lot of infrastructure and important firms in the hands of the state. The privatization that was manufactured then was more or less not so shockingly aggressive as in other countries, and workers had some part in it in the privatization. So they tried to in a way to develop some kind of social democratic rule, as I said. But this ended with this was abrupted by two processes. The first was the entrance into European Union in 2004. It is paradoxical because these elites themselves, the center-left, who was trying to build social democratic Slovenia, had for another goal to join the EU, because they believe that EU is some kind of institution on the European continent that is the barrier of the social state, of the European type of capitalism, and so on. And they didn't realize at the time that basically they were going into a very different kind of integration, a neoliberal one. So when Slovenia entered EU, a lot of predispositions for social democratic politics were stripped away from this, from decision makers. For instance, we lost autonomous monetary policy. They lost a lot of maneuver space in the budgeting policies. They lost tariff and so on policies, so they could not defend the home markets anymore. So that was the first thing that abrupted the social democratic Slovenia that was developed in the 90s. The second thing is that the center left lost their first elections after 11 years in government in 2004, and right wing came to power, and this right wing was very aggressive. They were trying to impose the delayed shock doctrine in Slovenia, and when it failed, they tried to, with different maneuvers, they tried to use privatization as a tool how to develop their own economic elite in the country. And they did a lot of damage, of course, with aggressively privatizing the companies. The second thing that they had done wrong was that they completely opened themselves to billions of capital that was floating around in this era of financialization across the Europe, and they were sucking it very aggressively into Slovenia. For instance, Slovenia had even more than Spain. We had, I think that each year our construction sector was bigger for 40% in those years, in 2004 to 2008. So Slovenian budget, for instance, Slovenian GDP, for instance, was about 40 million at the time, and in several years they managed to accumulate debt that is estimatingly worth of 30 billion, so almost three halves of the state budget. It was not public debt; it was private debt accumulating in the firms. So of course, when the crisis shattered global financial markets, Slovenia, very similar to other South European countries, was hit by the crisis very hard. So we had a lot of economic problems after that. The unemployment doubled and so on. And of course, what was followed by economic crisis was political crisis. So people, in a way, lost their confidence in any kind of political organization, in political parties, especially the established one. And I would say that the peak of the resistance against the neoliberal rule in Slovenia happened in 2012 with the biggest protests held in our country in last 20 years, and they were self-organized. There were no trade unions or whatever standing behind them. People just went to the streets out of their anger and disappointment of how Slovenian story ended. So I will maybe stop here. That was the period when political space opened, the space for alternatives opened for the first time in 20 years, and we were then a young collective of Marxist-oriented theorists called Workers and Punks University, Delavsko-Punkerska Univerza. We presented the notion of democratic socialism as an alternative in this protest movement, and then we started to mobilize to build a political party shortly after that. And I will stop here.
Okay, so first things first, I would like to warmly thank the organizers for the kind invitation. I've heard a lot about Subversive Festival, and it's really nice to be here, finally, after the previous successful events. And the second comment is that this year's Subversive Festival coincides with a very significant memory day. And in this sense, I would like to salute the 70th anniversary of the anti-fascist victory of the peoples of Europe against the most horrible nightmare that our continent and our planet has ever experienced. If we try to do a flashback concerning how things came to this point in Greece, we need to see the political developments after the collapse of the military dictatorship in 1974 and the succession of Greece to the European Economic Community, which was later renamed to European Union in 1980. So through these years, this first decade, let's say, the basic political characteristic of the Greek political system was the absolute hegemony of a very quickly emerging socialist movement. The foundation and the very quick victory, electoral victory of PASOK, the Socialist Party, which gained power in 1981, being a party with a very radicalized agenda. Unfortunately, this agenda was never vindicated and never fully realized. In Greece, we haven't seen even earlier, after the World War II, the end of World War II, we never saw the construction, or later after the collapse of the dictatorship, we never had the construction of a genuine welfare state. Instead of that, we had the construction of a clientelist state, a deeply corrupted mechanism whose public and social services have been really much more vulnerable than what it happened in Western and North Europe. So after this first decade, let's say, in the 80s of social democratic ruling, in the beginning of the 90s, Greece experienced, let's say, the shift to the neoliberal paradigm. There was a short-term right-wing government from 1990 to 93, which started the first aggressive neoliberal policies. And then the next governments that followed, majority PASOK governments, followed the same path through also the transformation of this party to what we know from Britain, the Blairite social democracy, which made the definitive turn of social democracy to extreme neoliberalism in most of the cases. So many people say, in the discourse for the crisis, many people insist on the fact that the trade surpluses of the core of the center economies of the European Union are trade deficits of the south, of the periphery. But actually, this is half of the truth, because throughout this period, we had the explosion of the financial sector. In Greece, this was accompanied by a huge scandal in the stock market, which exploded in 1999, and then a few months or 1 year later, it collapsed and led to hundreds of suicides of people who invested all their small fortunes to the stock market. And through this whole period of the last 20 years, we have had a huge concentration of capital through loans, through cash flow in Greece, which created this bubble growth. This bubble growth that was accompanied by other big national ideas, like, for example, the organization of the Olympic Games in 2004. To give you a historical detail, these Olympic Games are the only contemporary Olympic Games that without a financial report after they ended. Nobody has been taken to court or jail for one of the biggest scandals that Greece has ever experienced after the fall of the dictatorship. Anyway, in most of these years, we had the absolute majority governments led by PASOK, by the Social Democrats. But also since 2004, we had the shift to the right wing, to the New Democracy Party, which back then was let's say, center-right neoliberal party. It became an extremist right-wing party, extremist conservative party after Antonis Samaras, the cursed prior prime minister of Greece, undertook the leadership after the defeat in 2009 by George Papandreou, the leader of PASOK. And but you know, the policies of the two parties have been almost identical, as we're talking about recent years. And they promoted this bubble growth. I told you about the case of the stock market. We had the same bubble growth in real estate and construction. And we had the huge escalation of unofficial and illegal employment. And despite the nominal increase in some cases of wages, actually the purchasing power and the real value of salaries has been reduced. To give you an example, the real wages in Greece in 2009, before the crisis, were of this, on the same level with the real wages in 1988. After all these years of golden growth, the value of the real wage was the same as the mid-80s. So one day, actually exactly 5 years ago, George Papandreou, the Prime Minister, the Social Democrat Prime Minister, announced to the Greek population, after being elected a few months before with a humongous 47% in the elections, he announced suddenly one day from the island of Castellorizo in the southeastern water borders with Turkey, that our country has invited the IMF and the European Union and the European Central Bank to help us. As you all know, this has been a very painful help, because actually it has never been kind of helpful. Many European leaders are talking about European solidarity. We have seen no European solidarity, and I don't want to be provocative. I'm speaking with data. 93% of the money that were given to Greece through the famous loans of the last 5 years were money that returned to the foreign banks, making the Greek crisis one of the most profitable business for German, French, and other European banks. And at the same time, this model of super austerity for tackling the crisis has created a humanitarian disaster in my country. While at the same time, the public debt raised, after all these austerity measures, from 120% of the GDP in 2010 to 175% of the GDP this year. So, the official stats, economic stats, never improved. Greece passed through a period of 6 consecutive years of recession. This is impossible for a country which is not at the war, but it happened in the Greek case. And the social factors created a nightmare easily felt in the daily life of the Greek society. And this is natural, because our country has lost 25% of its GDP in 4 years because of the austerity policies, followed by both social democratic and right-wing governments. We had, it's this vicious circle. Big debt led to austerity measures. Austerity measures led to either the stagnation or to recession of the economy, and this created the need for more loans. So it's this vicious circle, the non-sustainable circle of neoliberalism, that has proved to be a complete failure, but it's still followed by the European Union leadership as a political and economic recipe, as if they are some kind of religious fundamentalists who cannot recognize what the real numbers say on the paper. I will finish this first introduction by giving you some numbers. You know that in the 25th of January, we had the historical political change in Greece. The country that we took in our hands is a country with 27% of general unemployment rate, 60%, 60 60% of youth unemployment, 1.5 million unemployed people, 3 million people without social security coverage, 300,000 Greeks as migrants in the last 4 years, among which more than 100,000 young scientists. In analogy with our population, this is the biggest brain drain we have seen in contemporary years in the European Union. And a reduction of the minimum wage by 25% in the years of the crisis. So it dropped down to 586 euro and 510 euro for young workers and employees up to 25 years of age. And an increase of suicide rates by 40% since 2007. Not to mention the thousands of households that have lost access to electricity, access to basic goods and social services. So, the social forces did not stay as mere viewers of the situation. Since 2010 and the elaboration of the first memorandum of austerity, we have had more than 20 general strikes in Greece. And at the same time in 2011, as it happened a few months later in Slovenia, we had the emergence of the so-called movement of the squares, an unprecedented social movement stimulated by spontaneous calls through the social media, as it happened in other cases of countries, which, although defeated, because we didn't manage through the movement to go to elections, but to a change of government in the parliament, keeping it in the same policy direction, although defeated, it created a fertile ground for the development of our values and our political alternative. Because it helped thousands of people who have never had contact with politics, who refused to have any kind of involvement in politics, to get politicized, even primarily, and become more friendly to the possibility of having an alternative. And at this point was the point that Syriza put on the table the question of power. That we are opposing, we are resisting, we are demonstrating, we are saying no, but this is high time we put our alternative in concrete effect. It is high time we change the balance of power. And then we can discuss later about what followed. Thank you.
Sorry, Marko, I was thinking maybe to give the word to Antonio because the Spain example shares resemblance more to Greece than you can use mine.
Perfect. So first, thank you for the organization of the festival, for this kind of awesome welcome. And it's quite a great thing that only 1 year after our foundation, we are being invited to this kind of festivals. For us, it's unbelievable, so I thank you so much. I also like to say thank you to my comrades here from Greece and Slovenia who are resisting right now in the government against the austerity policies. I would also like to say thank you to the Workers' Front, who is trying to build some kind of alternative here in Croatia. And I pass like 2 days here trying to know everything about them, and I hope that they can make something like us and my comrades here. So I was listening what they were saying, and I think that is like the same story in every periphery country in Europe. You know, you are, for us in Spain, like the periphery of the periphery, so you are in a worse situation than us. But I think that we are something, a common generational thing about this bubble growing construction thing, this post-transition system that falls into disruptor. So I think that maybe the data are almost the same. We have 25% of unemployment rate, 60% of youth unemployment rate, even in some zones of Spain, like in Andalusia, in my town, in Jaén, 70% of unemployment youth rate. It's like too much for a country like Spain. This is 4.5 million of people without anything to eat, and it's too much for us. So, but the starting point is pretty clear. The Slovenian friend said it. This opens like a new political space to do another thing. In Spain, we have, you know, the transition from dictatorship to democracy like 30 years ago. And there was some kind of a consensus, a democracy consensus, but this consensus is now broken. And when consensus are broken, there is a field that it opened and people is willing to get a new consensus. And if you don't put that on the table, the others are going to put it for you. And we are like pretty lucky in Spain, because normal when the consensus is broken and there is the people is not, I don't know, happy, you have three electoral expressions of that. Right, extreme parties, like I think you hear, and in Greece you have this problem. Abstention is the other expression of these people that is not happy. And this duopoly between the former Labour and the conservative ones. So, and it keep going like in a circle and so on, you know. So in Spain, the turning point was the 15M, the squares full of people, you know. And there were many things going on at the time that made 15M possible, and many things had happened since. Open flat platforms in defense of the public service. The Podemos hypothesis would be impossible without that. There are connections between these social movements and Podemos, and people are always asking about that. Podemos is not the party of the civil society in the NGOs. It's an important part of us, but it's not the party of this movement, and we have to understand that. But yes, it's impossible to explain Podemos without this 15N thing, you know? And in that time, the most important thing is that the traditional party system definitely falls into this rupture. Right now, after the European elections, the conservatives and the Labour systems, for the first time in the democracy, don't have more than 50% of the vote. That means that there are growing some kind of alternatives. We get 88% of votes in the European elections. Izquierda Unida, Left Unity, get 10% of votes. The Liberals also get some kind of good votes. But the important thing is that the duopoly, these oligarchic things, doesn't feel natural anymore. Doesn't feel natural anymore. So, little by little, we could put on the table things that, until that moment, people never said. We were doing things like asking, how cost a chauffeur? How many money cost a chauffeur? How many money cost that you travel in business? And that creates some kind of popular culture in Spain, you know? All people were talking about that things. And that is the thing that we use to put ourselves on the table. So I prefer that you talk and maybe questions, because if not, we are going to fire all the time. So thank you. Let's go.
Okay, is this okay? Yeah. Well, I'll try to be a bit shorter, because my historical point, part of the debate is familiar to people here since they live in the same country as I do, but a few things I think are maybe worth mentioning that I found like a common thread in the first two speeches is that the arrival of a right-wing government and the subsequent economic and social collapse created the conditions for a genuine left-wing alternative. And I think that's maybe something we should keep in mind with the coming general parliamentary elections in Croatia. which are, as we all know, probably slated to be given to the hard right conservative HDZ. Maybe that will create the sufficient amount of discontent and anger among the people that will create a space for a radical left alternative explanation of society and economy and all the rest. Well, I would say a few things only before we move on. I would like to compare in some aspects with what Luka said, because his Slovenian experience is closest to our own. There are a few very important differences, whereas we did not have a social democratic state up until the early 2000s, where the privatization and deindustrialization started immediately and were led by a, as we all know, a right-wing party. And then in 2000, when the so-called social democrats came to power, they just continued and strengthened the already existing neoliberal policies in accordance with European Union regulations. One of the first things that they did is to break down the import tariffs, which blocked, you know, the flow of cheaper imported goods that were meant to help the local production. That's what the left, so supposedly left-wing government, one of the first things that they did was to take that away, and so that enabled the input of cheap German, Austrian, and all the rest goods. So in that sense, our experience is a more negative one, in the sense that we did not have this safety net that we do. The whole consumption is in Croatia is debt-based, which is being financed by foreign banks, which with the interest rates two or three times higher than they are in the home banks, in the home countries. And that did not really see a change in these 25 years in any systemic or worth mentioning way. I would prefer not to go into the ideological part of the, I would say, rabid anti-communist rhetoric that we have to deal with compared to, for example, Slovenia. That should be maybe left for a later point in this discussion. But one thing that we did miss out on, because the organizational capabilities were not yet ready, were our own mass protests in 2011, which were in some way union-sponsored and motivated, but a lot of people came regardless of the trade unions, and you could feel the discontent, but there was no, at that time, there was not a sufficient alternative way of organizing, of doing politics. And now, with my own party, with the Workers' Front, we have an attempt, at least, not to be too, you know, sure of ourselves, we have an attempt to do that. Well, one thing that I think also is very, very crucial is what Antonio said, sorry, is that what needs to be done before anything else, if you're planning on having a radical alternative, is to show with the chauffeurs and with the salaries and with all the material benefits that come from doing political work that you mean business, which means that we cannot have professional politicians in that sense. They cannot be paid 3,000-4,000 euros. They cannot have their own chauffeurs. They cannot have their cell phones. That is something that and each of us here and each of our parties and anything, in my opinion, similar to that needs to do from day one and needs to advertise it, so to say, from day one, so people realize that we're not in it for the money, we're not in it for personal success, we're in it to try to take away the hegemony of the pro-capitalist, neoliberal, all of the parties. And to do that, we simply need to be different on each level all the time. Not just in speech, but also in speech, because media is, as we all know, very important, but also in program, in daily life, and in just the way that we act towards the society, if we have any ambitions of being an influential politically part of that society. We need to be completely different, because what they all said, the mainstream, the two-party duopoly is being shaken and being destroyed in front of our eyes. Not identically in all countries, somewhere it's still stronger, somewhere it's not, but you can feel the discontent of people everywhere. They realize that it's a rigged system, they realize that the game is against them, and now the only small, not so small of course, part is to construct an organization which will channel this discontent into something truly useful, sustainable, social, in the socialist sense of the word, of course, and it's up to us to try to do so. So that would be it for now. We can go maybe with some more questions so that I don't monopolize the speech. Thank you.
Thank you, Marko. Antonio has mentioned that Podemos is not the party of NGOs, and since all of these four organizations kind of rose from the social mobilization that were happening on the streets, on the squares, and so this was one of my questions that I maybe did want to ask later, but what the hell, why not now? What is the connection of your organizations? What was the connection at the time of your establishment, and what are these connections now? And I mean. In a broad sense, like NGOs, like civil initiatives, and unions, of course. So maybe we can, with Antonio.
Yes, thank you. Yes, when we think in the NGOs and in, for example, the 15M and all the people in the squares, there are one different thing between the people that is watching TV and people that is in the squares. Normally, the people that is in the squares are pretty critical with the representative system. You know, they hate this thing that you, there are not direct democracy and that you have to vote the people and then the people that do the things. But the people that is in their house, they are sharing the critical point of view with the social system and with the education system, but they are not critical with the representative democracy. You know, so for making Podemos work, you have to join these two realities. These people that is critical with representative democracy, and these people that is agreeing with that what the people are claiming in the streets, but are not participating of that. And these people is not critical with representative democracy. People like my father or my mother that are former ex PSOE voters, Socialist Party, they are not critical with the representative democracy. They didn't know what is direct democracy. And this is one thing. The other, the NGOs things, they are always running in front of us. The parties are always in the behind. They cannot achieve all what the NGOs are telling us to do. But we are learning all the time from them. For example, when we came up with our transparency system, we look in the whole Europe, which one was the most transparent NGO that were claiming for things like publishing every ticket in the website, these kind of things, you know? We were looking in the NGOs to learn things. We understand the NGOs like the avant-garde part of Podemos, but it's not a part of Podemos.
Maybe Luka.
Okay, thank you. I would say about this one that Initiative for Democratic Socialism and United Left, Združena Levica, was in a way born in the social movements. It was born in the protests of 2012, but on the other hand, as Antonio said, we are not trying to represent as the party of those movements. We are not trying to usurp those movements. Those movements can and should do their things without us, but we are looking for common projects with them. So, for instance, if I give you concrete examples, we are now having two big three big projects. One is struggle against privatization, the second is legalization of cannabis, and the third is equality for homosexual couples, so they could marry, adopt a child, and so on legally. We actually passed that one in the parliament. We gained. Okay, thank you. So how did we do this projects? They are not simply parliamentarian projects. In all of the projects, we are trying to involve civil society, to involve movements, and to do things with them and hands in hands with them. So for instance, when we had and we are still having a struggle for equality of homosexual couples, because the judicial court in Slovenia is pretty right-wing, and it can fall and will have a referendum on that issue for the second time in last 4 years. But we are now with the community, with their movements, we are building resistance against it. So if the law will be abolished, Constitutional Court, we will go along with them for public campaign, for protests, and so on. So that's, for instance, a way of collaboration with those movements. And we are trying to do very similarly on other issues. And we also have now the Združena Levica is coalition of three parties, the Initiative for Democratic Socialism, party called TERS, for Sustainable Development, and the Workers' Party. So we are coalition of three parties, but we have the fourth block, that is the block for the movement. So the movements that feel themselves, for instance, that United Left is 100% their political option. We are, of course, trying not only to collaborate with them in a way that I described before, but we are trying to make a coalition of those movements to do politics with them together. So in brief, I would say that is, for instance, our relation.
Well, that sounds like a nice synergy of movements and political party. Maybe Marko now, and then I have, considering the different stage of that Syriza, is a little sub-question on this matter for you.
Well, what needs to be pointed out, you know, to be honest, that our own party work and development is currently at a lower level. So we are in the initial phases, but very close to what Luka and Antonio were saying. Our goal is to try and engage with those that, of course, have an interest for some cooperation, to engage with non-governmental organizations and movements without it appearing as if we are just trying to take over or co-opt or direct them or anything of the sort. I can give a few examples. Some of our, several of our party members were in the foundation of the Stop TTIP coalition, which then continued its work, not to say independently, but separately, so that it's not, party-based, which might alienate a part of the civil sector. We will focus on helping as much as we can and as much as they will invite us on organizing this year's Zagreb Pride Festival, Pride March. And several other, we have good, very good relations with the anti-fascist NGO and with one more worker-based breed that some of you may know. It's a base for workers' democratization and initiative. The point would be to speak generally to all the NGOs. The point would be to try and persuade them that in the final instance, without taking state power, our ability to influence things is very limited. And it does not necessarily have to be through, you know, being actual party members, although that's the best option, you know, but we can understand that there are limitations to that. But the question of being present where the actual economic, social, and all other political decisions are made, directly present is the key issue. So our work in the future will be focused on that. So trying to be as close as possible to them without, you know, being overbearing, but all the while underscoring our point that it's, from our perspective, it's high time that something new and radically different than what we've been having for the past 25 years takes power. I mean, that word may be sounding, you know, power does not maybe come easy as a word, you know, people immediately draw comparisons with corruption or, you know, dictatorships or whatever, but if we don't, as a, you know, some sort of progressive part of society, if we don't hold state power, somebody else will. And that's what we want to send as a message to the ecological movement, to various worker initiatives, to the LGBT movement, because all of those are marginalized and oppressed parts of society and under being so under capitalism. And without an organized movement, which does not have to be all completely party-based, which will challenge it, we will forever be on the defense. And we're, as long as we're on the defense, we are in a losing position, basically. So that's our basic general idea. The point is to take power.
Yiannis. Check. Yiannis, when Leo Panić was in Ljubljana, recently he, prior to the Greek elections, he expressed the concerns about if Syriza gets to the power, what would happen to civil society, and that the best people could be drawn up. So maybe from that aspect, what did happen, and is it a problem for now, or do you see it happening?
Okay, so let's start with a little flashback. If we try to see historical backgrounds that have to do with our contemporary political space in Syriza, see, the most significant part of activists, at least in our party, have followed or are a continuation of the former Euro-communist tradition, and then which was later transformed to what we call in Greece the renovating and radical left. So according to this tradition, our political space has always had an approach of full respect to the autonomy of the social movements and the civil society. And this has a wide range. It is applied from trade unionist action up to universities, local communities, or the emerging thematic social movements. There are two significant moments that reshaped our identity. I think that the most fundamental of which has been the anti-global movement, the movement against neoliberal globalization, and the involvement of our forces, because Syriza did not exist back then, in the social forum process, in a process which was trying to overcome the deficiencies of the historical left through the elaboration of an experiment called unity through diversity. So through this process of the social fora, the European Social Forum, the World Social Forum, and the creation of national social fora, in Greece we had the Greek Social Forum, we managed to comprehend the necessity to have what the Italians first said in the beginning of the last decade, the contamination of ideas. Not to be afraid to test our ideas in the dialogue with other forces that might range from other radical left groups up to progressive representative of religious initiatives, like it happened in Genova demonstrations, or like it happened in the social forum process. This was this involvement of our political space reshaped our identity, especially of the younger generation of activists like mine, and actually led to the creation of Syriza. Because Syriza is carrying and has managed to unite as a political experiment a very wide range of ideological and political backgrounds, ranging from people who were in the past orthodox Marxist, Leninists and pro-Soviet, up to the left of social democracy, Greens, feminists, people who came from grassroots movements and NGOs. And the second decisive period was the movement of the squares. Because of this heritage, because of our involvement in the social movements, in the new social movements in the previous decade, Syriza was the only left party, while the Communist Party of Greece denounced the movement of the squares as being a petty bourgeois movement. We were the only left party that felt quite okay with that movement and got involved since the first day, since the first day that assemblies were organized. Because we had this culture, we had this mentality. Of course, after the 25th of January, we have new questions. And I'm not here to give you very definite answers, because, you know, things that we have been discussing only on the theoretical level must be tackled in a very practical way now. For example, the relation between the party and the movement was a question that we have resolved in the way that I described. But when in this equation you add the government, then things change, the discussion changes. Because it is difficult but also very crucial to keep this sensitive balance at all times between among the party, the government, and the autonomy of the social movement and the social struggles. Because we don't want to do the same mistakes that, for example, the Social Democrats made when they were still radicals in the 80s, when they equalized the party with the government and then institutionalized all the spontaneous social reactions. The situation of the Greek trade unions is dramatic. We're talking about corrupted majorities of social democrats in full accordance with the conservative trade unionists. In Greece, we have unified trade unionists. We have the tradition of two confederations, one for the private sector and one for the public sector, where all political identities participate. We don't have separate trade unions according to each political space. So the situation is really dramatic because we have majorities in most of cases consisting of social democrats and conservatives, very corrupt majorities that were an integral part in the building of the clientelist state in Greece in the last 25 years. And as a result, trade unions excluding precarious workers, because they cannot embrace the questions and the aspirations and the problems, and they do not even institutionally accept them to enter the trade unions, people working in precarious working spaces. They exclude female participation. If you see the composition of trade union leaderships, there's only a handful of women participating in the. They exclude migrant workers, and at the same time, they are unable, you know, to have an active role in the fight for the restoration of labor rights that we are giving in a central political level. We are fighting for the restoration of collective contracts and the minimum salary in the private sector, and the trade union confederations are doing nothing in these directions. And we are the government, eh? They are doing nothing. They refuse to contribute to this fight because it is a fight. The fact that we have the government does not mean that we have power. Yet, we hope, we're fighting day by day with very hard state mechanisms that are really hostile or against the oligarchs. And in this fight to restore workers' rights in the private sector, you need to clash with the big sharks, the big oligarchs that became, you know, the cornerstones of the old political establishment. And in this fight, we don't have the trade union, at least on a top level, standing on the same side of the fight. And it's really dramatic.
Well, I have to admit that I didn't have such a picture of Greek trade unionism in light of all these relatively often general strikes and mobilizations.
I'm not referring on the basis of the trade unions. Here, there, on that level, you can find really interesting and militant initiatives. I'm talking about the top level. Eh?
Oh, so the pressure from the base is forcing them to act a bit more militant. But there's a lesson for us here too, and for coping with our trade unions. So we have seen that manifestation of crisis were somewhat different, but what is the common ground is that the capitalist system is pushing us in those crises, and many of you, I think, have stressed the EU framework of neoliberal framework as a problem, and so if we can continue our discussion in the way of rethinking Europe, which we all I think want a different Europe, what can we do about that in present state of powers and constellations? Maybe Yiannis again, because they are in power.
Not in power.
Okay.
We have formed a government. Obtaining power is something much more difficult to achieve.
Okay, maybe you can tell us something about that briefly too.
Anyway, about the question what to do in a European scale. You know, many comrades from other countries, when we meet in international meetings like this, they ask us, what do you want us to do in solidarity with Greece? Our constant answer is change the balance of power in your own country. This is the new political meaning that we need to give to the term of solidarity. There are wonderful networks of practical solidarity to Greece. We have had thousands of volunteers from all over Europe contributing whatever they can in order to help us in practical terms, to help the voluntary healthcare centers, to help the collective kitchens, to help all the solidarity networks of Greece by gathering money or by sending us clothes and shoes and any kind of goods that we distribute through our networks of practical solidarity. But when we're discussing about the level of politics, the question is, if we are talking about the need to change the balance of power in Europe, then this means that we need to start from the nation state, from the national states. And this is a very hard struggle. We have the emergence of a number of left forces in a number of countries, as it was already mentioned, but it is a very difficult and a long-term process. The deepening of the crisis opens political spaces for the left, not only for the left, but also for reactionary forces, as it was mentioned earlier. And there we need very efficient left political subjects. Very efficient in a sense that they should be open, they should be willing to converge with forces with which might be in contrast until yesterday. Now we are in a new period, in a new historical era. And in this historical era, we have specific dividing lines having to do with the prevalence either of the dominant strategy, which has destroyed the European idea until today. In the name of European idea, they have destroyed the European idea. It's either this or a progressive alternative that while being critical to this model of European integration, in reality, and because of this, it is the most pro-European, because it puts on the foreground the necessity for the solidarity of the peoples of Europe. It puts on the foreground the essence of the common class interests of all the working classes around Europe, and then the fact, the realization that this is not a confrontation between nations. This is not a confrontation between Greece and Germany in total. This is a confrontation of the working classes of our countries against the bourgeois, against the oligarchs, against all those forces of the capital that maximize their profitability even in the period of the crisis. This is the message we wish to send, you know, to every corner of Europe, that today more than ever what we need is a new sociopolitical majority. In more theoretical terms, a new historical bloc. And this historical bloc certainly starts from the national level, because we still don't have, let's say, the formation of a fully recognizable European working class. But it cannot be limited to the national state, because anybody that believes that we are in historical times, that you can build socialism in one country, to remind me of a dark past and some mistakes that have been made, I think that is that cannot comprehend the essence of globalized economy, of globalized policy, and at the same time the necessity of globalized struggle.
Antonio, you are the member of the European Parliament, so maybe from that perspective, which kind of solidarity has any impact, if ever so?
Okay. Yes, well, I'm not a member, I'm not a deputy in the European Parliament, I'm more like an assessor there. So, yes, I have to say that I am fully agree with what Yiannis just taught, but where we think about the European Parliament, we see it like in a far, far away system. You know, when you ask to the people in Spain what is the European Commission, only 1% of the people know what it is. The European Commission, the executive part. And only 1% of the people in Spain know what is TTIP. Only 1%. It's quite a dramatic situation, because, you know, we have studies that say that the 80% of our legislation is doing up there. The important one, the economic one. Well, they sometimes left us this kind of woman rights, homosexual rights, and you can choose that in your state. But the economical one, the sovereignty one, is not up to you. We are seeing right now this with the Greece negotiations with the Troika. We are seeing that the most important things of your legislation, the one that allows you to give in it for your people, you are not choosing it. So we have here this tension that Yiannis described between how could we recover some kind of economic sovereignty without giving up with the European idea. I don't think we have a solution to that right now. I don't see it pretty clear. But this is the tension. This is the tension. I don't prefer to say.
Okay, maybe to get back to the EU framework and what it does to peripheral countries, Slovenia has somewhat longer experience with the EU, so maybe Luka first, and then Marko, what does the EU brings to us?
Okay, I would say, if we generalize things a bit, I would say that EU basically institutionalized the neoliberal rules. It is artificially, my thesis is that neoliberalism was developed in many different ways in the world. For instance, first we had experimentation experimentations with it in Latin America, like Chile, the fall of Allende, and so on. And the neoliberal rule was imposed military. So military junta takes the power and imposes neoliberal rules in one country. Then in Anglo-Saxon world, we saw Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. We had neoliberals elected, but here in the continental Europe, especially its western part, the trade unions, the social democratic institutions, and so on, were, I would say, too strong and too deeply rooted to be just swept away in this way. So my thesis is that European Union was in a way used to bring in neoliberal rules top down. So it was like under the rhetoric of European integration, you had basically neoliberalization of the states that were joining or accessing the European Union. But the real question is what to do now. Here I cannot agree more with what Yiannis said. The instant question is try to change the relation of power in your own country. And if we, the more left parties and the more left hegemonic blocs and the more left governments we will have in Europe, the more chances we will have to change it in whatever way. I mean, I would say that exit or no exit is now a pertinent question for Greece, but for the it's not, I would say, the most important question right now, because either way, if we want socialist Europe, we will have to have some kind of unification of it. Now, will it be true European Union by changing it, or out of European Union by building an alternative historic bloc, as Yiannis said? It will be basically a political question at the time when we have the predispositions, and that is the more left parties, left governments, and so on in the Europe, the better will be chances to do that. But for the Greece and their debates, what to do with exit or no exit strategy, it would be the best for Yiannis to answer, not me.
So I have prepared a few more, let's say so, questions, but I was suggested that we should start with the questions from the audience. Maybe, Marko, if you want to answer this question, or maybe...
Maybe just a few sentences. Just a few sentences to build on what was said. I think that there should be no illusions about the current state of European Union, and the best and the only needed evidence for that is the way that the institutions of European Union deal and have dealt with a democratically elected government of a member state of the EU. And I'm talking, of course, about Syriza. It's not just a question of different ideologies. This is a complete contempt for a democratic process of a sovereign state to rule its own situation, affairs, of course. Sorry. But to try and be a bit optimistic, one more Syriza-like government in the EU is 100% increase. And, you know, we are 100% stronger just by having two voices instead of one. And five voices is already to have a fraction, you know? So I would say that the final issue of building a more socialist Europe is, of course, a far-reaching question. But when it comes to the question of fighting against them, so to speak, I think that we need much less. We would do well with three or four for start, you know? For maybe present here or some others, but what is needed is not to waste any more time, but what is needed is exactly that, changing the balance of powers in each member state.
Okay, thank you, Marko. Okay, so we can begin now with the questions from the audience. Are there any? Oh, there are.
Glad to see you. I am Boris Bogdanić from Zadar. I'm a member of a Socialist Workers' Party in Croatia. I have only few questions for you. First of all, Mr. Mesec and Mr. Milošević, we had in ex-Yugoslavia self-management. You are too young, but I think that we have to do in whole Europe back to the future which we had here in ex-Yugoslavia, to the self-management and self-organize of the people. A second question for the you from Podemos. You have big cooperation in Mondragon. What's your opinion about that? Thank you very much.
Well, what I to answer the first part, I would try to answer it in a maybe more general way. I think what is needed in our society, and maybe in Slovenia's, but Luka and his comrades have started this work, what we need is a left criticism of Yugoslavia, because for the past 25 years we have had right-wing criticism of Yugoslavia, and the nationalists have completely dominated the discourse. So now it's a dungeon of people and a communist nightmare, whereas what I personally believe we need is a left criticism which would maybe see the errors in the high levels of party bureaucracy in relation to the supposedly completely socialist, autonomous self-management of the workers, which a lot of case studies and a lot of literature says that the self-management was not complete and was not ideal. It is definitely the way to go, if that's what you want me to say. Of course it is, but what we need to do is learn from the past and try to avoid the mistakes that were being made, particularly in the relationship of the high level of the party elites, and the fact that without sufficient democratic control in the party itself from below, there's a great danger that those elites will lose their revolutionary fire and start, corruption and petty material and self-interests. But definitely, what we've had here is a great historical experience from which we have to learn, but I would be against blindly copying or just going back to the future without a previous analysis of what went right and what went wrong. And that's what we will hopefully what we will do someday.
So you cope, you strive for some kind of negation of the negation. Okay, Luka.
I won't waste time. I totally agree with what Marko said. Amen.
Man. Okay, Antonio, the question about the cooperatives, namely Mondragon, but you can tell generally if you want.
Yes, I will talk it generally. So we have great relationship with cooperatives. What we are trying to do right now, I'm going to put one example that can be maybe clarifying for you. We are giving 2/3 of our salary the whole time to support this kind of movement. For example, every month one MEP, one deputy, receive in European Parliament like 8,000 euros. So 3,000 are going to the party, or 2,000, and the other 2,000 are going to some projects. What are we doing, for example? We are supporting the anti-eviction platform, we are supporting Meet for People, and right now we made some new arrangement in which people can send us projects and then let the people vote these projects. So we receive like 300 cooperatives projects, and we have 50,000 euros to put in these projects. But the people is going to choose which project are we going to implement. So yes, I strongly recommend that if you go to the power, please give the power to the people to choose their projects that and the politics that they want for the city. Yes.
Hello. I have a question for Yiannis. In former Yugoslavia, we had one of the systematic values was valuehood of brotherhood and unity. Now our long-lost sister Macedonia has conflict, civic conflict. I'm sorry about the echo from the mics. I don't know what's going on. Has a civic conflict. One of the reasons of this conflict, besides economy, is, of course, partly Macedonian nationalism, which was woken up by Bulgarian and Greek temptations to their territories and ban of their name. Does Syriza, and this is the name of the panelist, the New International, has a proposition to Macedonia about its name? And would you allow Macedonia to be named Republic of Macedonia as they want, and which is one of their basic human rights? Thank you.
Well, it takes two to tango. And all the previous years we got none. Eh? Because all the previous years our side had governments that were completely negative towards the direction of a commonly accepted solution. So now we have the one dancer from the one side. Our government is willing to reopen the discussion sooner or later. You know that for us at the current period, talking in a scale of weeks and months, the important thing is to finish with the negotiation process in the European Union to see what will happen in the next months in our countries. But concerning our foreign policy, I believe that it is more than evident that we are not going to follow the path of the previous governments. And we want to play a constructive role in a region which is tormented by very crucial and very negative political and geopolitical developments. We have a number of open crises in the wider region, and we don't want to make this crisis more. This means that we have to tackle all the open issues one by one. It's not only the long-term conflict between I will be politically correct, the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia and Greece. We also have the conflict for the Cyprus issue, which is open. We have unresolved issues for the relations between Greece and Turkey. We have unresolved issues concerning the clash of nationalisms in the Balkans, in the wider Balkans, as we are very dramatically seeing a localized escalation these days in Kumanovo. So I believe, and in general, what I can promise you on behalf of the Greek side is that in the next period we will try to play as more constructive role as we can. But again, I hope that the other side, concerning this specific issue, the progressive people, the progressive movements, the progressive forces of the other side will also try to do their best, because, you know, we had the conflict of both nationalisms. It's not one's fault. And the current government, Gruevski's government, in my opinion, has played a negative role in the direction of resolving the issue. And I already said that our governments played a negative role as well. So we need to see changes. The change in Greece has started, and I hope that in the next period we can talk in completely different terms.
Uh, So I am from the French context, and we have a lot of leftists on the ground. If I understand correctly, Syriza has benefited from anarchists in many ways, and as you said, the Spanish Podemos has benefited from the square movements. From that point, I'm wondering if this new left is not simply a parliamentary symptom of on-the-ground activism, and to what extent can even 7 or 8 new lefts in European countries meaningfully stop something like TTIP? Should this new historical bloc be parliamentary? Thank you.
And the question is addressed to whom? All of participants. Okay. Who do first?
Well, from a purely legalistic point of view, it just takes one government to stop TTIP. And so far we have that one government. So, but that's not me trying to downplay the importance of grassroots mobilizations, which are in the end one of the things that put this government in power, and hopefully will put others also in their countries. But unfortunately, unless we are talking from an anarchist point of view, and personally I'm not, the question of, here's how I would like to phrase it, one foot in, other foot out. As optimistic as it may sound, but I think you both need a radically left, more socially progressive government in power, and then maybe even more radical activists on the ground pushing it leftwards and criticizing it when it goes off course. And that seems to me, if not ideal, because nothing is ideal, but probably the closest thing to that I would sign to. So you need, you know, non-parliamentary forces as well as a parliamentary presence in my perspective, in order to have long-lasting changes. Because otherwise you're just reacting, your actions are reactionary in relationship to someone else holding power, and that's not what I would be satisfied with.
Well, I think I gave quite an extensive analysis of our approach towards the role of the social movements and social struggles in a previous round. In our political experiment, and I'm insisting on the term experiment because Syriza is trying to constantly evolve and correct as many mistakes as possible. We don't have a discussion which is contradictory, so it's either parliamentary struggle or grassroots struggle. These two are dialectically interconnected. The rise of Syriza was based on its very active participation in the developing social struggles, in the grassroots movement, in the localized initiative, initiatives in every corner of the country. The rise of the radical left in Greece, since our first steps, first the survival of this political space and then the development of this political space, was based on the fact that our activists, our militants, our membership has the mentality of swimming like a fish in the water, as long as our relation to the social movement is concerned. So I believe that this is not a dividing dilemma. I believe that we are talking about dialectically connected levels of building hegemony and winning power in a step-by-step approach.
Okay. Thank you. I agree with what was said before. I mean, I would say that I agree with the point that socialism has to be built by the people, not by the government top down as some socialisms in the past were. But if the government is against the people, then we have hundreds or tens and tens of years of experience
how far can the socialist project go if you don't have the other side, the other foot, as Marko said. So I wouldn't say that we are some kind of usurpers. I would say that the new left parties are an opportunity also for the anarchists and for the people who don't want, who want to change the world without taking power. We are the new left parties are someone who they can talk to and seek for help also from the state side.
Okay, Antonio. Something to add?
Maybe another question.
One more question then.
Hello, I'm Ivana, and I have one but very difficult question to whomever one of you gentlemen would feel inspired to answer. Now, this week it's quite impossible not to go back to 1945 and the ending of the World War II. And at that age, there was one idea was formed, which is, was and still is behind the process of unification of Europe, and that was the idea of interdependency as a voucher of peace. And however many times that idea was in one way or another betrayed, I would still like you to offer something which would be an alternative, which would in fact lead to safeguarding this process in which actually, to grossly oversimplify, if France produces tomatoes and Germany produces cabbage, for instance, their self-interest in engaging into conflicts is actually much more pronounced than in some previous system. So what do your parties actually have to offer which would serve as strong enough of an incentive to prevent future conflicts in an economic sphere? Thank you.
So, when I talk about, when we talk about the nationalistic problem in Spain, which is, you know, quite a big one, I'm going to tell you what we are trying to do in Podemos, because maybe that is useful for you here. I don't know. So, you know that we have one nationalist problem in Catalonia and also in the Basque Country, and people is always asking, how do you solve this kind of big problems that are like 200 years inside? So we say the next thing, let the people vote. We don't have one program about if we should be an independent Catalonia, should have an independent Catalonia, or an independent Basque Country. We said, let the people vote it. And with these kind of things, I think that is the best solution. You cannot force the people to having one program in your party. They cannot offer you one close, full solution to these kind of problems. They can only offer you one referendum. So I think it's the best way of solving these kind of problems.
Well, I'll be short, so, since our political line on many issues is not quite formed yet, but this is now just my own view. I think that one way to go in that direction is to try and remind people of the material base which brings us all together. Because nationalism, as we all know, has always been used to divide and conquer the working class. We had an attempt which was not obviously good enough to move beyond that once. But I think that there is no real alternative to having at least part of your public communication deal with the fact that, you know, to use the old school terminology, proletarians of the world should unite. And there are many practical ways in which you can do it. For example, to smash through the fake idea that Germany as a whole indivisible unity body is somehow dominating the rest of Europe. Yes, the German elites are dominating the rest of Europe, but it's only because their economy is more competitive because their wages were frozen during the tripartite pact, which means that the German worker lives worse and worse every year. What we need to do is to try to explain to our workers that they have a lot in common with the German workers. And that's what needs to be done, especially in Yiannis's case, where the tension is, you know, huge, Greece, Germany, and all that. What needs to be done is to, in my opinion, is to try to fight that rhetoric with a unifying rhetoric of our own. And in a practical sense, those questions should best be need to be answered from the position of having power. What I would like to do is to have a, you know, socialist revolution everywhere, but the practicality of that is much more difficult, and I wouldn't pretend to have an answer right now, other than this general one, which isn't just so general after all, because it's true, you know, we
okay.
are.
Okay, if you do not have an answer, please stop, so that we can have two brief answers, because we are running late.
I already referred to this character of confrontation that also Marko included in his suggestions just now. I would like to go back to, well, first of all, we need to include many parameters in this discussion. One parameter is the class conflict, but also there's another parameter, which is the environment. When we're talking about the productive reconstruction of Greece, we're not dreaming of having a Greek Volkswagen factory. But on the other hand, the most advanced economies should understand that if we want to build a democratic model in Europe, the fact that Germany is the champion of exports should mean at the same time that we have an increased European Union budget, a distribution of these funds in a socially and environmentally sustainable way, and that Germany would contribute more to this budget. And what we're seeing prevailing right now is exactly the opposite, tendencies to reduce whatever existing forms of economic solidarity, with Merkel putting Cameron in the past to play the role of the bad guy. Now Cameron, of course, is threatening with a referendum, which is another very long discussion. So we have the tendency for the reduction of all the last or small or even secondary measures of economic solidarity in favor of neoliberal authoritarianism. What we should discuss, if we want to speak about the democratic and sustainable model, sustainable in every sense, economically, environmentally, and in terms of maintaining peace, would be how this famous European solidarity is practically exercised. Because what, let's say, the European South needs at the moment is not more money to its banks. It needs all the help it can get in order to improve infrastructures, to improve the way of production, in a progressive way improve, not in terms of capitalist competitiveness, to improve all this scientific knowledge that is needed in order to exit this unsustainable model of bubble growth. And this is a recipe that has to do with the whole of Europe and not only the South, although this discussion is, you know, located in most of the cases on the southern countries because of their bigger economic problems. So I think we need a comprehensive approach, including all these elements.
Okay, I think that what you are asking is probably the hardest economic question for all socialists, and I think that socialist theory hasn't really answered to that efficiently yet. Namely, what you are describing, you can see that the driving force behind the problems that you are describing is market competition. But now, what is the mechanism that can that can replace the market competition, that is the real question. We have seen the flaws of central planning, we have seen the flaws of that types of economies. So I would say, I would answer you in that way. In short term, or in mid term, we can name a few measures that would increase solidarity in Europe. Yiannis was already describing, for instance, we would have to boost the, how is it called? The cohesion policy of Europe. For instance, the USA, they have the differences in development between their states are far from that what the differences, the amplitude of differences in Europe, but the USA use 20 times more budgetary funds for what did I say before
the word
to balance then Europe, for instance. So that is, let's say, one mechanism that could help to resolve the problem that you were titling. But in the long term, what we have to do is, I think we have to revive the planning debate. So what kind of economic planning could be efficient, could bring solidarity, could bring some kind of social consensus to remodel our economies? Because as long as you have market competition, you will have tensions just as the one that you described.
Thank you, Luka. And thank you all very much. We are now over. We are running late already, so my apologies to participants of the next panel. The last message maybe would be to help these people to build a new and more social Europe. You should join progressive and revolutionary forces in your community, whichever you find them.